remarkable story of Pudsy the Wonder Dog begins and ends in Lurgan, County Armagh, but reaches all the way to Hollywood, California. It is possible that I could take some credit for making Pudsy famous, although the real honour lies with his owners, Barney and Bella Mitchell.
The night of the first Blitz in Belfast, an awful lot of people were homeless. And as well as that, people were so frightened, they left their houses and wanted people to try and go down to Belfast and try and get these people rehoused. Now, Bella was one of the people that was appointed, and she knew Barney, and, well, she knew him to see and knew who he was and all. But apparently he had a lorry. So, of course, Bella got him with a lorry and they went down, and that was the beginning of the friendship with Bella and Barney.
Barney and Hoa got together and they got married, and that was a great occasion in Lurgan.
They lived at number 23 Edward Street, which has now disappeared. It was on the left-hand side going down Edward Street, and it was like a two-up, two-down terraced house. Out of the back, Barney had one of these cars that was like the type of thing that we used to see years afterwards in all the Al Capone films, you know, the thing with big running boards on it.
Barney was a man of about 5'8", and more solemn in nature and quieter, very deep individual. You never seemed to, you could get so close to him, but then you had to stop.
Barney was quiet, nice fella too, but quiet and reserved.
Barney was all go, a great wee man altogether.
Barney was a man you had to speak to before he spoke to you. He didn't make conversation, in other words. Very, very reserved sort of man. Very different from Bella. Like, it was Bella done all the talking, you know, she was that sort of person.
Barney was a complete introvert. And Bella was a complete extrovert. Bella just had to know you 5 minutes and you were your long lost friend. Very quick at making friends.
From the time I met Bella, she was my friend till the night before she died. Bella, a great, great, great woman.
Bella, she was tall and stoutish, and she had nice auburn hair, nice curly hair.
She's a smallish woman, but she was always larger in life, and wherever Bella was the centre of attention.
Oh, great fun, and if you got into chat with Bella, she was very entertaining.
Bella was a personality in Lurgan, and a good neighbour, and a very charitable person.
Barney went round the country in a van and collected all these bags from the farmers, brought them back, and Chewie and I sorted them out, folded them up and all and stacked them, and he brought them back to the factory and got good payment for them.
Barney picked them up on his rounds when he was out collecting the bags. A farmer or somebody offered it to him. And he was afraid maybe to bring it home, but he wasn't sure if Bella liked dogs or if she didn't. But he took the chance and brought it home anyway.
He was a wee terrier dog, something on the style of a Jack Russell. tan and white. Look at a lovely wee dog.
Wasn't it a kind of white and black and white, you'd say? And Barney would have been taking it up the street, you know, for a walk. And it's always with him. And of course, everybody knew the dog, especially around Edward Street.
Very friendly, that it would lick you any time you were in the house, come up to you and put his head in your lap. And as a little boy, it was just wonderful to be about that type of dog.
A priest that was out in China called with her, and his magazine, The Far East, that was issued monthly, had a cartoon character in it called Pudsy. And for a bit of fun, he said when he was in one day, "Have you this dog baptized?" "No." "Well, I'll baptize it now." And he baptized the Pudsy Mitchell. And that's how the dog got its name.
The dog, it could talk and count, I should say. It could count. Mm-hmm. And Barney and everybody knew the dog. They called it Pudsy.
The talking dog, as it was known throughout the town. And as we as children called it the talking dog when it came to come to school. And he brought it up to the convent school, and it could count better than most of us.
Barney found him out on a few occasions and wondered how he got out. And on watching him, saw him nuzzle with his nuzzle up the bolt of the door and move it back and let himself out. And afterwards, I saw him do it on command. But he no one had thought to teach him that. He certainly learned that and did that himself, which wouldn't indicate that he was a dog with some initiative. First time I saw Pudsy was in Edward Street in Lurgan, and I was going towards Bella's house. I was a very small child myself, and I was going towards Bella's house, and the dog came across the road from Jordan's newsagent shop, facing where Bella and Barney used to live. And the dog had the Irish News in its mouth, and it came to the door, and it sort of nudged the door open with its head and went inside. And whenever I got into the house, the dog was in the living room, given the paper to Barney, and Barney was sitting down in his seat, and he says to the dog, "Pudsy, go and get me my slippers."
It was a great favourite with the children round the doors. They come in and would knock the door, and Barney would go out, "Is Pudsy coming out?" They just treated Pudsy as if he was a human being and a child. Bella used to nurse him and tell him the lovely boy he was and all the rest of it. Barney, he spent an enormous amount of time training them.
He always said from the beginning it showed above average intelligence for a dog. He then proceeded to teach him to roll over and lie dead and to climb ladders and to count, to bark up the numbers.
If Barney would have said, "Pudsy, 4 and 4, dog would have barked 8 times. And if he had said, "Pudsy, 6 minus 2, the dog would have barked 4 times. In those days it was special because here was a dog that could count. And it was amazing. And to me, as a young boy, that this was better than Lassie. Lassie couldn't count, but Pudsy could. So Pudsy, you know, was a very, very special dog, and very special in the fact that it belonged to my aunt and uncle.
Jimmy McMahon and I ran a concert in St. Joseph's Hall, and we heard about Barney's wee dog, Pudsy. And we decided to have Barney and Pudsy on the stage that night. I think it was his first appearance. I think that was 1950. I remember young boys going around the front of the stage and asking the dog questions such as arithmetic. And there he come up with the answers, "Great." And then they asked him questions on subtraction and again, right.
I
And then I remember Barney asked him to kneel down and say his prayers.
Barney says, "Right, Pudsy, say your prayers." So the dog would get up onto the back of a chair, you know, sit on the seat of a chair and put his two paws together and put its nose down into its paws and just sit there quietly until Barney told it to get up and go again.
It did do other tricks, like lie down and roll over and stand on his hind legs.
And begged, you know, for biscuit or sweet, whatever it was, and then rolled over and then tried to do, you know, we'd kind of a wee dance.
I was his assistant in many of these escapades, and I think I appeared once on stage with him. But the dog would count the batter, or he would count, or I would bend down and he would jump over my back. And generally, like all acts like that, were very popular. People were, even if they weren't amused or believed, they were entertained to see the dog do his various tricks.
Barney would have threw a cigarette at when he finished it, he threw it down. He threw it down purposely to show me what the dog would do. And the dog just came over and he just kept stamping on it till he put it out. It was a most peculiar action, you know.
Barney would give someone a sweet or a chocolate or a piece of some bread, something to give Pudsy, and he'd say, "Pudsy, now don't take that." And Pudsy, people would try to shove it in his mouth and he would turn his nose like that. And then Barney would say, "Pudsy, take it," and Pudsy would go.
He held up cards, or he got a child to come out of the audience and pick a card out, hold it up to Pudsy. Many's that.
Somehow or not, it came to the attention of a fellow called Terry O'Sullivan, who was a journalist in the Irish press.
You're not expected to believe a word of this story, but it's true. I saw the whole thing, and I tell you, there's a dog in this country who can count up to 20.
Pudsey is his name, a smooth-haired fox terrier, and he lives in the coal cellar of his master's home in Edward Street, Lurgan, the cleverest and most educated dog in Ireland.
The type of things that Terry O'Sullivan was saying was that this dog was as good as Rin Tin Tin or Lassie. I think when we started to call it like the Wonder Dog of Ireland, you know.
When I called to his home in Lurgan, Barney Mitchell told Pudsy he was wanted, asked the dog to sit up, and then said, "How much is 2 and 3? Pudsy barked 5 times. 6 and 6, said Barney. Pudsy gave 12 single barks, then waited for more.
The type of shows that Barney would have brought the dog to would have been variety shows. That before the time of television, every parish had its own monthly variety show, which would have been people singing, somebody else doing a dance, a comedian, and any sort of variety acts. They were basically non-professional shows held in village halls and church halls, and usually for the purposes of raising funds, but to build another church hall or to help with church funds or whatever.
It was great entertainment, Pudsy. And had he been getting paid for all the charitable work, he would have had a fortune.
No, he is not for sale. Pudsy does not perform professionally. His master has no ambitions to earn big money for himself. In fact, Pudsy has never earned a penny.
Terry O'Sullivan put it into their head that he should take him to the States.
Both Bella and him had a sort of a yearning to go to America. So the idea of going to bring the dog to America and to get it to star in movies at the time started to become a reality in their mind. Barney had a brother who was out in America from just before the war, and he had a family out there.
Bella had always the American dream, for when she was a child, my aunt came home from America and promised her when she was 18 she would claim her out there. But sadly and unfortunately, by the time Bella was 18, my aunt was dead. But she still kept the dream. She still had the dream in her head.
Pudsy, the mathematical wonder dog of Lurgan, is going to Hollywood. This was the news by Private Wire, which sent us off to County Armagh last week to interview the wee fox terrier discovered by the Sunday Press a year ago. You may remember that when we last met Pudsy, he proved his right to be called the cleverest dog in Ireland by adding, subtracting, and dividing. probably the only star to be groomed for Hollywood on bones and biscuits. We found him at home at 23 Edward Street, Lurgan, relaxing after lunch and in the mood for receiving pressmen. How did you first discover you were a genius? We asked. We have met film stars before, don't you know? And we can tell you that you can't lay it on too thick. I was always a superior kind of dog, said Pudsy. Never mixed much. Studied a lot. Earned my bones the hard way. Always chased cats. Just an ordinary dog to look at. But I knew all the time that someday I would rise above just being a number on a license. The little dog from Lurgan leaves on the Mauritania from Cove in a few weeks' time to try his fortune in California, along with his owners, of course, Varney and Mrs. Mitchell. If he is not snapped up by somebody's television network, I'll eat this page. The only sad note comes from the kids of Edward Street in Lurgan. The day they have to say goodbye to their pal Pudsy, who loves all children and hates all cats, there'll be tears in the street. He's a great wee man.
They were all delighted that the herd was heading for Hollywood, and they were over the moon learning about it. And I thought it was a great thing. It was worthy to go for it. It was a great wee dog. It was brilliant.
There was a traditional thing in Ireland that when someone was going off to this, particularly to the United States, played any part of the world, but it seemed to be associated with immigrants leaving to go to America, that the people in the locality took the view that there was such a long journey and that they were most unlikely to ever see the person again. So what they did was they gave them a wake, as if they had died and gone away from them. And these were called American wakes.
After the famine, when people went, they were never returned. And it was to say goodbye to you. It's just a living farewell. But times were different in the 1950s. People did go and people come back very quickly. But Bella did not recognise that at the time. And she was in very deep grief for going.
It was a terrific night, great night, fun, and yet it was sad too. Everybody was very, very sorry Bella was leaving Lurgan. Very sorry, and Barney too. Barney was very well liked.
Barney didn't attend it. Could be that he was too cut up about going, or maybe he was a shy person.
There was anything up to 500 or 600 people died. Every neighbour, from the top of Edward Street down to out to Silverwood, there was one out of every house.
You weren't invited, you just went to the party. And it was a great night. Everybody baked and brought cakes and sandwiches and all. And there was great fun and great singing.
Well, this is the end of a perfect day, near the end of a journey too. But it leaves a thought that is big and strong, with a wish that is kind and true. For memory has painted this perfect day with colors that never fade, and we find at the end of a perfect day the soul of a friend we've made.
It was talked about around the town now for years afterwards. The great night they had at Bella's party.
She didn't want anybody to see her going. They left very early, and they took the dog with them.
The morning she went away, I cried. I cried because I wasn't allowed to go with them. They went down to Cork, but I wasn't allowed. And I remember them getting in the car that morning, and that was the last I saw of her.
The dog was let out every now and then, and Barney walked up and down with it. And then he took it in again. He didn't even put it in the boot. It was kept like a child in there between them.
SS Mauritania from the tip to New York, and all this time Pudsy was in a wicker type basket for the journey.
There's only one thing about it that we laughed about, and that was at the time Crombie coats were quite in fashion, and Barney was dressed in a Crombie coat and a hat to go to the highest temperatures in California.
Going across the Atlantic, people on the boat was all admiring the dog, and Barney showed the dog off to the rest of the passengers. Harbor in New York, these friends that they had out there greeted them, and they kept them for a few days in New York, and everybody made a great fuss of the dog, and of course everybody was reaffirming Barney's position about, oh Barney, that'll be a big success in the movies, that.
While they were there, Pudsy entertained and was even at shows there, and everybody thought it was great, and they were well built up on
him. The next part of the journey from New York, they went by train, and the two major parts of the trip was get across to Chicago and then from Chicago down to Los Angeles.
And Barney twice daily had a look at the dog and fed him.
They got successfully across to Chicago, and when they got to Chicago, they then changed onto a different railway company, which I think was called the Union Pacific Railway Company.
All railroad stations, large or small, are very interesting places. For example, at most railroad stations, you will usually find the Railway Express. You will see people checking and sorting packages to make certain that they will be put aboard trains which will take them to their destinations without delay. And remember, they will handle almost anything, including your dog.
The guard on the next leg of the journey would not permit them to keep the dog with them in the carriage the way it had when they travelled from New York to Chicago. And he took the dog in a box that Barney had provided and put it in the guard's van. And the guard's van was closed up. Barney asked, well, what am I going to do about saying to the dog? And they said, oh, don't worry, we'll let you in and out to see it. But when they got on the journey, the guard and the train wouldn't actually let them into the van. They travelled on through what was a hot, sunny afternoon in 1952 across the hot plains of that part of America. About 3 hours later, they stopped at a station called Clinton, and Barney again said, we need in to see the dog. And when he opened the guard's van, he couldn't see where the dog's box was, because everybody else that had got on the train at the last stop had piled all their stuff over it. Barney and the guard pulled all the luggage away, and Barney opened the door of the box, and the dog was dead.
everybody's waiting to hear how the dog was going to get on. And then the word came through that the dog had died. We sent word to Kitty, maybe, or some of them, you know. And then everybody said, oh, did you hear about Barney's poor dog? The dog died.
Word from owners Bella and Barney Mitchell in California. Pudsy is dead. They told us Pudsy died on board a train outside Chicago on his way to the West Coast. The little fella had smothered in a boxcar in which all the ventilators were closed.
Barney, he wanted to bring the dog on to Los Angeles, and the railway company wouldn't let him do that. And one of the railway men took the dog away from him, and he buried it beside the railway tracks, somewhere near Clinton, Idaho.
The brief started. Now, how they ever got to California, Bella said when she came home, she doesn't know. Well, if it had been a child that died, they wouldn't have been more depressed.
I often wondered what the picture was like when they got to Los Angeles, and Barney's brother and his family, and there's a wider connection of people from Lurgan, were all meeting them there. And when they got there, like, how did Barney and Bella go onto the platform and explain to them, you know, like, we're here, but...
That was really devastating. Well, to me as a young boy, that was hearing even sad news of the death of a brother, because there was Pudsey had died, and again, when Pudsey had died, they'd lost their great opportunity.
They were all sympathising with me, as I thought it was somebody belonged to me, a human being that had died. They would come over and say, oh, I was terrible sorry to hear about the dog dying.
It was an awful pity that he didn't reach California. He would have been as good as any of the rest, such as Lassie and Rin Tin Tin. He was a brilliant wee dog.
Somebody put it into their head in America that they take it to the court, that they had an open and shut case.
Barney pursued a legal action against the Union Pacific Railway, and that legal action of itself, when it was finally determined, became a precedent in many other cases in the US. Initially, Barney pursued the Union Pacific Railway, and while he was preparing his case, the case was kicked out by the court, saying that there's a limit of liability of $25 on any animal carried by the railway company. Barney then appealed to a higher court.
For the purpose of exhibiting a trained black and white fox terrier named Pudsy, the appellant and his wife, accompanied by the dog, left their hometown in Ireland to come to the United States in June 1952. The intention was to show the dog on television, in the movies, and displaying him to the children of the United States.
They were sympathetic to him that they'd come all that way with the dog, and that at least he should be allowed his case to be heard. So he got over that hurdle, which would have been pretty monumental.
First case they had, I think it was $12,000 they were granted. Then it was appealed, and the appeal was thrown out. Then they had to have another case.
Plaintiff claimed that Pudsy could give answers to problems in addition, subtraction and division in any combination up to 20 by a number of barks. Plaintiff testified that the only prompting given was his tone of voice.
But I think the things that were against him is that the dog had never actually earned before. You know, he had done charities at home, but he'd never actually got earning before. And there was no proof, like, that some of the big studios were sitting waiting on this wee dog.
Plaintiff said that the dog was known as the Wonder Dog of Ireland. Plaintiff's experts said that the feats claimed for the dog by Mr. Mitchell could be accomplished. This, the railway's experts said, was impossible.
We never got much word. It was sort of a cover-up. They were hiding something, I thought. Well, they were hiding the fact
But any money they were making, they were spending in lawyers.
Luckily enough, in the higher court, which took him to 1960, I think it was, that was 8 years from the time he'd gone out there, the higher court stood over the award and eventually he was paid the $12,000. So he really spent the first 10 years in America trying to sort out the reason that he went there. I don't believe he ever got over that whole episode.
At times he was very depressed, you know, and he'd be thinking and deep in thought.
He had left Lurgan to go out there to make it big with his dog, and he had no intentions of ever going back to Lurgan. He didn't want to go back to Lurgan disappointed, nor did he want to go back to Lurgan to discuss it with people. They lived in a wee town called Garden Grove in Orange County, California. Barney found work with his brother.
Bella was a florist. She worked in the flower shop.
The pictures that I remember that Bella sent with her letters were of Barney working on a catering van.
They moved up in 1970, I think it was. They moved up to San Francisco.
Bella used to come home on holidays, but Barney would never come home. It's, when I go home, it's for good. I'm not coming back anymore. I never went home for a holiday. So when he did come home, he did come home for good.
He seemed in the best of health. But a Friday night, I got a phone call from some of the connection to say that Barney had died. Couldn't believe it, because he was late. He didn't look ill, and I never heard him complaining.
He was brought back in this huge casket. Like the type of things that we had previously seen, like on television, where you had President Kennedy lying in state in one of these type of caskets.
I said, but I would hate to bury that in the ground, because that would make a lovely thing for holding blankets. But I insisted Barney was getting nothing, only the best.
Barney's remains were brought into St. Peter's. Everybody was amazed when they saw this big, big coffin coming in.
It was a great big casket, everybody was saying, oh, look at the size of that. And the top part was open that you could have seen Barney.
Of course, a lot of the comment would have been about, you know, the usual Irish one, how well he looked in the coffin. But in Barney's case, that was probably so true because of the American processes of embalming and so on. And I think a lot of people would have been curious about that and come in to see it. But it was really like a lying in state, you know, that he was back in Lurgan.
If he didn't go away, celebrity, he came home quite a big one. And somebody told me, but whether it was true or not, I wasn't here to verify it, that's where the coffin was lying. In the church in Lurgan, a black and white mongrel come in and walked round it. I give you that for what it's worth. Whether it's true or not, I don't know.
Time.